Yeah, this is John Keane on Radio VPRO.
1969, was it?
Pardon?
1969, was it something in the year?
Yeah, 1969.
Yeah, really big hit.
Yeah, it's very big. 9 countries, number one.
Uh-huh. In 9 landen, number 1. But the only one as yet.
Yeah.
Tot nu toe geen andere.
I could cry about that.
Welcome in the studio, John. First, I have to explain something about your career to the listeners. You don't care?
No.
You don't mind?
No, I don't know.
John Keane heeft in 1967 een liedje geschreven voor The Who. Dat liedje werd uitgevoerd op de LP The Who Sell Out, die in 1967 verscheen. Hij was voornamelijk liedjesschrijver tot het moment dat Pete Townshend van The Who op het idee kwam om een nieuwe groep samen te stellen uit 3 zeer uiteenlopende heren. De liedjesschrijver John Keane, die nu naast me zit, Andy Newman, een zeer vreemdsoortige boogie-pianist. That's right, Andy Newman is a boogie pianist, or how would you describe that?
A boogie pianist is perfect.
Yeah, is that okay to you?
Yeah. He's a 1930s boogie pianist.
30 jaar stijl dus. En verder was daar Jimmy McCullough, die in die tijd 15 jaar was. En heel hard op een gitaar speelde. Quite a strange band, wasn't it?
Very strange at the time. Not many people understood it, you know.
How did it work? You went on a tour after you had to hit Something in the Air. You went on a tour in England.
Yeah, we were forced to go on the tour really because of the success of the records, you know. But, you know, the tour really was, you know, the killer in it, because it was put together on a very loose, friendly social level, and to suddenly have the pressure of backing up a single really was very difficult at the beginning, you know. After about 7 months of hard playing in every club and every gig that ever had a band playing it, it got really, you know, kind of nice then, though, you know. Yeah. But it was very hard work at first. It was very hard work when you know, you were kind of going on the stage, right? Or you play a gig and it'd be like the electric jack plugs, right? With
the electric what?
Jack plugs, right? With 30,000 watts, you know what I mean? You know, followed by the, you know what I mean, the inflamed ear rolls, you know, with 50,000 watts, and followed by sort of like the golden spark plugs with 100,000 watts, and then Thunderclap Lumen, right, with like a 7-foot contrabass saxophone and a 30-watt amplifier.
Yeah, let me translate this, at least try.
Okay, yeah.
Thunderclap Newman had dus die hit in 1969 met Something in the Air. En als je een hit hebt, zowel in Nederland, in de popmuziek als in Engeland, dan moet je daar onmiddellijk geld aan gaan verdienen, want de mensen kennen dat liedje van de radio. En ze hebben die single gekocht en ze willen die band dan ook wel eens een keer live zien. En dan moet je heel vlug wezen. You have to be quick to cash in if you have a hit.
Yeah, well, you get pressure from the record company.
En de platenmaatschappij zit er ook stevig achterheen. Maar toen die zeer enthousiaste, maar niet zo erg perfecte tournee, want die groep was helemaal niet berekend om op tournee te gaan in Engeland. Well, the band wasn't really fit to go on tour.
Not really, no. It was put together on a much warmer level than, you know, like if you're 4 guys and you think you've really got something to offer, you going on the road is the fulfillment of what you've rehearsed and what you've got together. If we'd have made albums, it would have been perfect for us, because we had that balance. We had to compensate, we had to be compatible to each other, you know, because Andy would only play boogie, he would play nothing else. So I had to write the songs in such a way that I could get my song across, but also lean as space for him in the song, which contributed as well.
Yeah.
Just us and him, us and him. You know?
Het was natuurlijk een ontzettend probleem om die groep ingespeeld te krijgen, want die 15-jarige gitarist uit Schotland was daar en de boogie pianist die eruit zag alsof hij 50 was, maar in werkelijkheid was hij maar 30 jaar. Hij had een wit pak aan en hij wist echt niet van popmuziek. He didn't know about rock and roll, Andy Newman. So this was quite a job to do.
Yeah, it just meant that you had to swallow all the things you'd learned. In other words, you know, forget all your sort of rock and roll career and take it from that point. In other words, the speed that he would play your song at would be the way you did it. You know?
Mm-hmm. Het tempo wat de pianist aanhield, dat moest de rest dan maar volgen. Het was dus echt een liefhebbersgroep die min of meer overrompeld werd door die fantastische hit. And then you had an album called Hollywood Dream, and produced by Pete Townshend.
Yes.
And he also played bass on it, and I still think it's a fantastic album.
Yes, so do I.
Yeah.
I think it's an incredible album.
I'd like you to talk a bit about one very long number called Accidents. Het is een nummer wat gaat over ongelukken die aan kleine kinderen overkomen. Het duurt 8 minuten. En ik ga John Keane vragen wat nou precies de intentie achter dat nummer is. Is it really kind of a sick song, or well, how would you explain it to the listeners?
Well, you'll have to translate it.
Ik mag het uitleggen. No,
it was one of the very early songs I did. You know, I used to drive a truck. You know,
dat was vrachtwagenchauffeur.
And you know, I used to sort of like get these incredible emotional upsurges, you know. I'm trying to explain that.
Emotional upsurges. Yeah. Okay, let's leave that.
And you know, I just sort of like that's how Accidents come about. I wanted it to be a surrealistic song. In it's like a child care song in a way. I mean, that sounds very silly, but it was that sort of flash. You know what I mean? I just sort of suddenly, as I was driving down the road, would see these sort of like 4-year-old kids just marching around. You know?
Yeah.
And that's what sprang it off. But basically, it was supposed to have been a surrealistic song. In other words, the kids equally could have been killed in all the instances described in the song, or they could equally have gone on. But the onus was on us to make sure they don't get killed. Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah,
I see. Very sincere.
Oké. Het liedje is dus geschreven achter het stuur van een vrachtwagen. En John vertelt dat hij voortdurend in situaties kwam als vrachtrijder waarin kinderen nog maar net levend aan de overkant van de straat kwamen. En hij begon zich te realiseren dat het dus echt aan de chauffeurs. Het is de zaak van de chauffeurs om te zien dat het niet gebeurt. En well, anything else to explain about Accidents?
Well, basically, the track that's on the Hollywood Dream album is the first part is their accidents, right? Their description of their accidents. And the second part is them presumably going to heaven, which Andy did, right? And that's his part, and that's their journey to wherever they go, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the last part is the fulfillment of the total song, the meaning of what we were trying to portray in that particular song. And I like that, the accumulation of, like, it's like breaking the sound barrier, that's the effect we try to make, going from one extreme to another, really, you know.
Yeah, I see.
Which it does do, and as soon as Andy begins, you don't forget the song that's come before. For some reason it worked incredibly like that with him. You wouldn't, because normally if somebody starts playing piano like that, under normal circumstances you forget the song that's gone down before, you know, or what's happened previous to it, you know. But he had that sort of quality of playing things which, though they didn't fit in rock and roll terms, they fitted in sense terms.
In your songs, at least.
Yeah, very much. Yeah.
Well, het lied gaat als volgt. Het eerste gedeelte behandelt de ongelukken. Daarna gaan de kinderen naar de hemel. En wat daarna komt, dat is zo'n beetje de conclusie van John. Accidents, door Thunderclap Newman. Opgenomen in 1970 met Jimmy McCullough op de gitaar. Andy Newman aan de piano. Pete Townshend, producer, maar ook aan de bas. Who played the harmonica?
Chris Moffitt. Is a photographer.
And Speedy King, die het liedje schreef. Why are you called Speedy anyway? Speedy Gonzales, I know, but...
Yeah, comes from a long time ago, really. Really.
You don't want to talk about it?
No, I don't want to talk about it. I used to have a motorbike called a Speed Twin, you know? And, you know, like, to get anywhere as a drummer in the early days, you had to do, you know, what I'd term as, like, a Keith Moon, do you know what I mean? I mean, nobody could do it except for him, the way he does it. But you had to be fast and furious, you know, and everybody used to call me Speedy from the motorbikes. And it just escalated.
Escalated?
From there, yeah.
Speedy.
To the drums.
Yeah. What about Pete Townshend? He produced the album at his home studio. Pete Townshend heeft deze plaats thuis gemaakt op twee Rayfoxen, vertelt John Manette. En... well, it was kind of an adventurous thing for him to do in 1970.
Yeah, he used to, like, make all his own demos for The Who, right, you know, of how he wanted it to be. And on my life, I mean, they were incredible, you know, as they were, right, before he even did them, you know. He's always done that, you know. So that part of The Hill was already overcome. But, like, to play bass, we did most of it on two Revoxes. That's two track tape recorders. To play bass and mix down all at the same time, because once you do it, it's done. You've either got to redo it, or do you understand what I mean? When you mix things down and add things as you're recording, it's straight onto tape. And most of them were done like that, and I think that's, I mean, when you the production on it, to me, is superb, and the quality is superb.
Exactly, ja, het geluid van die plaat Hollywood Dream, die trouwens in Amerika, zegt John, maar ook net 162.000 exemplaren heeft verkocht, nog kort geleden. When was that, when the album was released in the United States, this one, Hollywood Dream?
When was it?
Right away.
Yeah, 69.
Yeah, and it also sold a lot of copies after you released the second one, Previous Convictions.
Right, yeah. Mm. Well, I think they've, you know, re-ashed it a couple of times, you know. Mm. The only thing is last year they released it, and they changed the cover, and I like the cover. I think the cover's very, what the record is, very upfront, you know.
Ja, de hoes is net als de platen, zegt hij. Je ziet drie zeer vreemdsoortige heren. De pianist Andy met bril, een zeer lange pijp, een pet op. Jimmy McCullough, die zo te zien op zijn schoot zit. En John met pet. En ze hebben een ouderwetse foto. Is het een... What is this? What is it?
I think that's the back compressed into the front. That's the camera, right? That's one of the very early movie cameras.
Okay, let's go on to the newer things you've done. Hij heeft een LP gemaakt, die heet Previous Convictions. De liefhebbers hebben hem in dit programma heel vaak kunnen horen. En op het ogenblik is hij bezig met een nieuwe plaat. You're recording at the moment. You almost finished a new album.
Yeah, I've just done
two. What's happening? What's going on the new album?
Well, you know, same thing, songs. I mean, I think it'll always be songs, you know. You know, I've just done a mammoth amount of recording since last October. And basically I went in to do a concept album. Mm. But like,
what do you mean by that? A concept LP?
Yeah, just a story, really, that the songs fitted around. You know what I mean? You know, and you know, which would have come out as a concept. You know, in other words, as a Tommy thing.
I see. So it's a story.
But unfortunately, you know what I mean? Like, as time caught up with us, inflation caught up with us, and I really, you know, got to the point halfway through where I thought, you know, nobody can even afford a double album these days, you know.
Hij zou eigenlijk een dubbele LP willen maken, of ongeveer hetzelfde. What is the subject, what is the concept on this new album that's going to be released in September, I believe?
Yeah, it's no longer a concept, unfortunately. Now it's two separate albums, right?
Yeah.
You know, such is life. Now they're two separate albums. So the first one comes out in September.
Het worden dus twee eigenlijk. It's going to be two albums instead of a double one.
Yeah.
I see. We're going to play one track. We gaan iets laten horen. Het liedje heet Crazy Love. Well, what can you tell about that? Crazy Love, it's clear enough.
Yes, clear enough. It's very crazy and very clear. Fresh too. It's amazingly fresh. Nothing. It's one of the early ones that we did in the first lot of recording. You know, and most of the songs I do, each one I approach differently. Apart from the Thunderclap stuff, where that had the same vein running through. You know, but like the previous Convictions album and these, the newer albums are, you know, mostly just songs, and they're all approached differently every time. You know.
Mm.
So you get, you know, kind of more color, you know.
Ja, de liedjes zijn allemaal vanuit de tekst op een speciale manier muzikaal vormgegeven, zal ik maar zeggen, als ik hem helemaal goed begrijp. Okay, can you announce it? Well, be a disc jockey for one moment.
Hello, hi there, this is John Keane on Radio VPRO, and I'm going to play you now an incredible song called A Crazy Love. So
much. You come around crashing down my defenses. You told me once or twice what you saw looked quite nice. Now you got me eating rice on Sunday. It's that kind of look in your eyes. That kind of look gets me high. There's no place for you to hide.
John Keane met Crazy Love. This sounds like a hit single to me.
Yes, no, it's that one.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, right.
who's playing the steel guitar?
It's a song of a man and his love, you know what I mean? You know, like, but anyway, yeah, okay. Who's playing steel? B.J. Cole.
Ah, B.J. Cole again. Huh?
Yes.
There's two steel guitar players in England, as far as I understand.
Yeah, he's one of them.
Yeah. Okay. Now, I have a little surprise for you. Oh, it's not really a surprise, but you'll be surprised anyway. Hier is een bandje wat opgenomen werd tijdens een televisieprogramma. Namelijk het continentale debuut van de groep Thunderclap Newman, waar we eerder veel over gepraat hebben. Dat was op kasteel Groeneveld voor de VPRO Televisie op 5 februari 1971. En het optreden ging grotendeels technisch en muzikaal de mist in, omdat de ruimte erg klein was en Jimmy McCullough heel erg hard gitaar speelde en dus de zang van John en het pianospel van Andy Newman grotendeels wegspeelde. But anyway, you remember that day.
I didn't understand that.
You didn't understand. Well, this is the tape that we made at a castle where you appeared as a group in 71. Was this it looked like the first time you ever played together, but it wasn't.
No, it was about 9 months together we've been then. But, but I liked it like that, you know. It'd be nice to hear this. This
let's listen to
it. I presume it would be very loose. I remember we were very loose at the time. Yeah, but I remember it was incredible gigs. It was really fantastic.
One thing I remember is that after the show, Jimmy sat on the lap of Andy Newman and cried his heart out.
That's right. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah. Jimmy McCullough huilde aan de borst van Andy Newman toen het voorbij was. Maar hier is nog één keer de legendarische Thunderclap Newman met Wild Country Live.
I'm gonna carry on with a song called Wild Country. Which is our next release. As a single. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, what about it? Did you like it?
Yeah, I loved it. I played good rhythm. It's fantastic.
You got a live recording of the group?
Yeah, two guys called Ronnie and Reggie Tan, right?
Uh-huh.
Sent me a tape of it about, I suppose, 10 months, a year ago, you know, and that blew my mind, you know, the fact that they'd gone to the fucking TV, the TV studio, do you know what I mean, and made an actual cassette of it, you know?
Yeah.
It was a bit loose.
Het was een erg leuk concert en bovendien heeft John een band toegestuurd gekregen van twee mensen die in het blad Oor al een artikel over hem geschreven hebben. Ronnie en Reggie Tan. Well, I got a quote. Ik heb een citaat van John uit een oud interview, in 1970 ongeveer, waarin hij over Amerika praat. You're telling the people... We've eventually got to go to America, I suppose. And from what I've heard, it stinks. Unless you like hamburgers this big and cars this big, that is. Well, that's pretty clear. You have been to America in the meantime. What did you think about it?
It's right if you like cars this big and... hamburgers this big, you know. I thought it was like, you know, it was like a Butlin's holiday camp stretched over, you know what I mean, like 24,000 miles or whatever, how wide or big it is, how big is it?
Explain that to me.
Well, what I mean is, it's sort of like I flew straight to LA, and coming from London, and all the things that happen in London, and in, say, Europe, and how it's very heavily involved in politics, it's very, do you know what I mean, you're conditioned to politics on the television, you know what I mean, you know, the situation is heavy, inflation, da-da-da. I mean, you know, to fly from London to LA, you know, for the first time, it's like arriving, and we have a place called Butlin's Holiday Camp in England, right, which is a holiday centre, you know, very famous now. Lots of camps all over. And it's like, as soon as you arrive, yippee! It's a holiday camp, you know. Welcome to Butlins. And it was like that going to LA, do you know what I mean? I suddenly saw thousands of geezers driving around in huge, great cars, you know what I mean? You know, but not actually doing anything, just driving around in huge cars. You know, no, I thought it was very, you know, gay.
Gay?
Yeah. Then, you know, after, obviously, being...
You never hear people telling that about America.
Well, I mean, it was LA, man.
Very gay.
Yeah, very gay. No.
Did you like it?
Yeah, I like the musical scene there, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But you do tend to find that everybody's kind of going crazy, and you feel like everybody feels, and seriously, everybody feels like tomorrow is going to be it. Do you know what I mean? So let's live for today, you know? Mm. And that, on a vast scale, can do your brains in if you're creative or if you're trying to, do you know what I mean, like work at something solid to communicate with people. Are just saying, if you keep seeing every hotel I went in America, I'd walk into the lounge and there'd be, oh, homie, it's only $100. I just just had to buy it. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, and that is sort of like America.
I won't translate.
Okay.
Tell me something about a number called Nightmares, which is going to be on the new album.
Right, yeah. Same, you know, basically it was part of the concept thing, you know. I should explain to you, I wrote a concept album whereby a guy gave 12 musical aspirations of what he felt about life, right? And mm-hmm. that was going to be the concept, you know, and the tracks linked. And this is one of the tracks, and it's just about, you know, the sordid subject and the shortage of food. You know,
shortage of food. Where
the shortage of food,
in general.
In general, yeah,
mm-hmm.
yeah. And the way we eat up our resources and destroy most of the other things. You know, what I mean, I'm not an ecology fanatic. You know, I just think there's real good subjects to write rock songs around. You know what I mean? And that mm. one was a particularly good subject for me.
Ja, het nummer gaat over het voedseltekort op de wereld. En John Key is niet direct een politieke liedje schrijver, maar hij houdt zich er wel terdege mee bezig. Are you a political songwriter, would you call yourself that?
No, the song's called Nightmare, because that's what it is. It's supposed to be just a nightmare, do you know what I mean? Contained into a song, you know? But I like to, obviously, we've all got to dig at it, otherwise we'll have nothing left. Do you understand what I mean? I mean, do you know what I mean? Everybody being eaten out of tins for the rest of their life, you know? And I like to be aware of those things, you know?
Wat als er nu op een dag niks meer te eten is? Nightmares. We kunnen voor de klok van 12 uur nog één nieuw nummer draaien. It's called Almost 18. How old are you?
And me, almost 18.
Well, it's the title of the
and
number.
A bit. No, it's an old 50s song.
Oh, I see. You didn't write it yourself.
No. Uh-huh. This song made Roy Orbison famous overnight.
Roy Orbison?
Yeah, it's the first song he ever did.
Huh.
And you see, I did a radio tour of America last year. And I met a disc jockey, in Detroit, you know, and for like 5 minutes. And I said to him, I like old 50s stuff, and I'd like to get some old, you know, Eddie Cochran demos, you know. And he says, yeah, man, I'll send you a tape, you know, and I never thought anything, right? When I got back from the States, there was two C90s, that's 90 minutes, 45 minutes per side, and full of stuff, and this was on it, so I did it as a tribute to him, you see.
Well,
his name's George Denham. Good old George. Nice one, George. Okay.
Say anything you like. Well, we're almost there.
I am.
It's been 12 years. And John, thank you very much for coming over here.
Thank
and,
you.
That's okay. And we'll listen to Almost 18.
Almost 18. Almost 18, I'm wild in love with a dream.
She says I'm the kind of guy and